to talk about what we have learned. So people have been doing this for many years. We've learned a lot along the way, and I'll give a little overview of what we know about the prevalence of these small, that is, rocky planets orbiting small stars. I'll describe the basic instrumental challenges here. Why is it hard to detect planets using the so-called Doppler or wobble technique? And then at the end, I'll describe a little bit in more detail about this project, Minerva-Red, which is a dedicated robotic telescope with a near-infrared Doppler spectrometer specifically designed to find these small planets orbiting small stars. Don't need to tell people in this room that the last 20 now plus years of the field of exoplanets has been really quite exciting. The rate of discovery has been growing. Not sure if it's geometric, exponential, or what, but now we're talking about thousands of planets. We've got statistically significant samples that we can use to study things like statistics of planets. We have good statistics, particularly for gas giants. We can measure the properties of atmospheres like absorption, emission spectrum, lots of interesting things about the dynamics of multi-planet systems. And also we're starting to do some more comparative exoplanetology. I think that's a word that Robert Lupton invented. And I think there's some implicit derision there that I've never really understood. But that's a lovely term. Star here. The results from both the planet and the star orbiting a common center of mass. So the game plan is to take a spectrum of the star, measure the wavelengths of all the tiny little absorption features, and you measure those wavelengths relative to some zero velocity reference you've got in the lab. You do that over time, measure the velocity of the star over time, you can see a periodic variation with a period p, and that variation has an amplitude. You usually use a simple k, call it the semi-amplitude. With some simple physics, like Kepler's laws and conservation of momentum, you can measure the minimum mass of the planet. They're still in front of you on inclination I, which is a major pain, and the result of that is that you only ever measure the minimum mass. Numbers to think about, Jupiter going around the Sun is about 12 meters a second, easily measurable today. Earth going around the Sun, 10 centimeters a second, not acceptable with current technology. Now, Kepler uses the transit method. With the transit method, we're detecting a planet as a result of the subtle diminution in brightness that occurs when the planet goes in front of the star along our line of sight. So you've got to be lucky here. Everything has to be lined up just so. You can measure the size of the dip in brightness. That tells you the ratio of the areas of the planet and the star. And again, some numbers. Jupiter in front of the Sun is like 1%. Gashbar and others have shown fantastic results using kind of off-the-shelf type equipment, you can detect a Jupiter-sized planet. Earth in front of the Sun is a much smaller signal. The Earth is much smaller. Kepler, the spacecraft, is designed in principle to detect these signals, but it's still a challenge. One key point is if you've got a transit and you've got your Doppler orbit, you have planet density. So you can do this exoplanetology thing. Where are we finding these planets, orbiting stars by and large? But most of these stars are sunlets. So on the right here, this is a histogram of the masses of exoplanet hosts. You can see it peaks right at about one solar mass, FGK dwarf stars. But of course, the majority of stars, that is, if you draw a box around the Sun, the majority of stars in that box would be little stars, more like 0.1 or 0.2 solar masses. This is the histogram. These are radio pulses. Yeah, these data are a couple years old. Right, most stars are these small stars. So, immediate question, is this because small stars have a dearth of planets, or is this because of some strong observational bias? And I'll tell you today about why I think this is definitely an observational bias. These stars have lots of planets. Why is there a lack of stars? So, that's a really good question. Like K stars, I think this is probably historical in some way. Over the first couple of decades of intensive Doppler monitoring, they were simply focusing on some of the stars. There are lower, that's because people have been would not have been detectable from the ground orbiting a star like the Sun. And the same is true for the Doppler wobble. All else being equal, if the host star is smaller, the signal you're looking for goes up. Doppler and transit. There's also a second advantage, this oft-touted habitable zone, which is frankly a pretty vague notion, but the basic idea is that you can put a sphere around a star, and at any point on that sphere, a planet would receive the same amount of radiation that we receive from the Sun today. It's a habitable zone, you call it a temperate zone, you call it a liquid water zone. The key point here is that as the star gets smaller and cooler, that equilibrium temperature zone moves in. So you've got to be much closer to a little star and maintain the same temperature. So as that planet moves in the habitable zone, the Doppler signal goes up. I mean, take Earth, we put it in the habitable zone of our Sun, it's 10 centimeters a second, impossible to detect. When you put Earth in the middle of the habitable zone of a little star, it's a meter a second wobble. That's about what we can do in terms of staging Earth. So you can detect planets in the so-called habitable zone. Right. Sorry. Yeah. I won't tell you whether or not he survives. And then finally, if one wants to go out and take a picture of a planet, get a high-resolution or high-synchronous spectrum of the planet atmosphere, which lots of people want to do, these nearby low-mass stars are particularly nice targets. Because these stars are faint, any low-mass star that we find planets around is necessarily going to be close by because you need high signal-to-noise data to detect a planet. So we find planets orbiting low-mass stars, they're going to be close by. That means the angular separation between the star and the planet is appreciable. And you might hope to separate out the light from the planet from the light from the star at JWST or a future high-contrast imaging facility. These are high value planets. What am I talking about here? I'm throwing around the word M-dwarf. I'm basically talking about the smallest proper hydrogen-burning star. So I'm basically focusing on these fellows here, less than a fifth, let's say, of solar mass. These are very small stars, but they are stars. They're definitely hydrogen-burning stars. And because they're small and they have low temperatures, they're incredibly faint. This is a little simulated image of three different stars, sunlight, early M star, mid M star, at fixed distance, and same exposure time. And this is to illustrate for you just how faint these things are at optical wavelengths. If you took a picture of these three stars in G band, say 480 nanometers of light, green light, you can barely even see these. 25,000 times fainter in this band than a star like the Sun. So you really want to move out to the infrared to hope to obtain any type of high signal to noise observation of this little star. What they lack in individual heft, they more than make up for in numbers. Within 8 parsecs of the Sun, there are about 200 proper hydrogen-burning stars. Something like 75 or 80% of these are low-mass stars. So we're looking at the peak of the stellar mass function. There are really a lot of these little stars that need significance. What do we know about their planets? People have been searching for planets orbiting these low-mass stars for some time. We've known for a while, maybe about a decade, that when it comes to gas giant planets, they have relatively few. It's a nice paper by John Johnson, published well ago now in 2007, where he showed that for orbital semi-major axes up to about 2.5 AU, the anti-correlation adjustment between close mass and rate of occurrence of planets. So small stars have few Jupiter mass companions. But over the past few years, in large part thanks to Kepler, we have, I think, a very exciting kind of emerging picture that these small stars actually might have lots of small planets. And by small planets, we call these things super-Earths and mini-Neptunes. I'll show a definition of those two terms. This is a great plot from 2012, a paper by Andrew Howard, where we're plotting the rate of occurrence of planets per star, versus stellar temperature, so cool small stars here, warmer stars here, for planets of different sizes. Draw your eye basically to this orange line, yellow line. These are 2 to 4 times the radius of Earth, basically super Earths or mini Neptunes. And it's sort of tantalizing to draw this correlation with your eye and claim that the small, cool stars have a really high rate of occurrence of planets. It's corrected for selection effect. So they take the number of planets and simulate a detection. a big table that I've actually pointed out here just to show you the takeoff. So if I look for planets with minimum masses in the 1 to 10 Earth mass range with periods up to 100 days, the lower limit, one sigma lower limit on the rate of occurrence is about 60%. So there are a lot of these smaller planets orbiting these small stars. And then a few months later, I had a very nice result from Courtney Dressing, another Princeton grad. She analyzed Kepler data. Now we're back to the Kepler data. And she looked at the small number of low-mass stars that are observed by Kepler. Most Kepler stars are much more massive than Sun-like stars. Kepler observed some type stars. And she basically determined that the Kepler data, are consistent with basically every one of these low-mass stars having a planet with a period of 50 days and a radius less than 3 times. Very, very exciting result. I can also draw your attention to a nice paper by Tim, who might be out there, and John Swift, doing a similar analysis finding, I think, even a higher rate of occurrence. So we have a clear picture that there are lots of these super Earths, mini Neptunes, orbiting these small stars. Very exciting. Tim? Say super Earth or mini Neptune. This is a really very exciting plot. I think a huge amount of work went into generating this plot. Jeff Marcy and a student with Weiss showing the planet radius on the x-axis versus the density on the y-axis. So for the dense planets, we actually don't have very many measurements. It's actually quite difficult to get the viewpoints that are there. But the takeaway is that it appears, based on what we know, planets smaller than about 1.6 Earth radii have rock-like densities, right? So you can put the solar system planets and a couple of other exoplanets on this relation, where the planet actually gets denser as it gets more massive because of the compression of the rock. And bigger than about 1.6 Earth radii, it seems like we're transitioning to something that's primarily gaseous, that has much less density. So these are your mini Neptunes, and you can think of your super Earth as something that's more than 1.5 or so, less than 1.5 or so Earth radii. Like a scaled-up version of Earth, most of the time. So you can go to this great website, Exoplanet Orbit Database, a neat website where you can download everything we know about thousands of exoplanets. You can plot the color of the star, the host star, the planet host, which you can think of as just a proxy for temperature. Hot stars, cool stars, small stars, bigger stars. And then the Doppler wobble, the size of the radial velocity variation for the detected planet. Lots and lots of detected planets. But there's a pretty conspicuously empty area here, right? These are low-mass stars, and these are Doppler signals that should be readily detectable, 10, 20, 30 meters per second. And it's surprising because these cool stars, they're numerous, there are lots of them. And I've argued that it seems like they have a lot of planets. So what gives? Why is it only one planet in this box here? I think you already know the answer, which is that there's an enormous observational bias. If I make a list expected population of planets based on what we learned about planet statistics from Kepler and the ongoing Doppler surveys. So we can take the stars we know about, what we know about the exoplanet orbits, something like a period radius function for those planets. We can take what we know about the planet mass radius relation. We can turn the crank on a Monte Carlo simulation, and we can simulate what planets are probably lurking out there orbiting these very nearby stars. Begin with the period radius function. Again, this is something that I think Tim probably has a better version of, but in this paper by Andrew Howard, they fit the distribution of the orbital period of the planet, the logarithmic band versus the rate of occurrence of planets. It's a broken power law that's relatively flat at longer orbital periods and then breaks for very, very short orbital periods. So we're going to make a big assumption here. We're going to assume that this is not only valid out to 100 days, but that it's also valid for these little stars. This is basically a measure for more massive stars, but we're going to assume the functional form is valid for the lower mass hosts. And we're going to normalize this, so 75% of our small stars have a planet. We can actually be conservative. We have to assume something about the distribution of the sizes of these planets. Courtney found her thesis work that the planets in Kepler tend to be uniformly distributed in the log of the radius. So we're going to assume that. That's the size distribution. But of course, Kepler measures planet radius. We want to get planet mass, so we can turn that into a log, into a Doppler signal in our simulation. So we're going to assume this very rough mass radius relationship. You can see there's an awful lot of scattering, right? But we're going to use this kind of best fit approximation again. So we're going to turn the simulated population of planet radii into masses using this relationship. So there it is. This is the simulated population of planets orbiting stars less than a fifth of the solar mass within 8 parsecs of the sun, periods less than 100 days. A couple of things to draw your eye to right away. One is that there are a bunch of planets in here, but there are dozens of planets. They're orbiting stars that are relatively bright in the infrared, 7, 8, 9, 10th magnitude, relatively bright in the infrared. And I also added this line here at 1 meter a second. So you can think of 1 meter a second as sort of state-of-the-art in terms of detection of planets using Doppler technique orbiting sun-like stars. So if we can do this in the infrared, these are all, in fact, readily detected. These are not particularly difficult detections in terms of the semi-amplitude. So we have to go out and try to find these planets. My simulation would indicate there should be some few dozen planets in this box right here. So these are some of our nearest stellar neighbors, the closest low-mass stars to the sun, and they're orbiting relatively bright targets. It should not be that hard. Well, so I assume the 75% of occurrence rate. So 75-ish, something like that. Why hasn't this been done before? I think it's interesting to think a little bit about detection. What does it mean to detect an exoplanet using the Doppler wobble technique? Good way to do that is to go back through the literature and look at all the published planets that were detected the first time with this technique, with the Doppler wobble. And you can calculate a sort of signal to noise for those published orbits, right? It's like the semi-amplitude, the size of the wobble, divided by the measurement error, times the square root of the number of measurements. You can plot that up, call it T, for hundreds of planets. You can see 51K, the very first planet, maybe they were a little conservative, so wanted to make sure it was a solid detection. But the bottom line here is that typically planetary orbits are published with like 40 observations at a T of something like 15. Bottom line is that the ratio of the semi-amplitude of the Doppler wobble to the measurement error is about 3. It's typically what you see for a published orbit. So why didn't the previous surveys detect this population of planets? So these are results from this very ambitious HARPS group. This is the Swiss planet hunting instrument. They carried out a very ambitious survey of about 100 of these lowish mass stars over a period of several years. And what's plotted here is the visual green light magnitude of the star versus measurement error, where blue points is what they expect from photons alone, and black points are sort of like what they actually get. So I just use a drawing tool here in Keynote to just sort of do an eyeball approximation of the measurement precision as a function of the magnitude. millisecond precision possible for any M star within 8 parsecs. And that's the goal of my project, the Minerva-Red project. It's a dedicated observatory for discovering and characterizing planets orbiting the closest home mass star system. It's a project led from Ian Penn, myself, and my friends, Dave Slisky, Upkeep Flat Chan, Missouri State, and then John Johnson. We begin by trying to determine what's the awesomest telescope you can sort of buy with a credit card. It turns out if you're Jeff Bezos, this is it. This is the largest mass-produced telescope. It's a company called Planewave. We're very impressed with this company. If you're looking at something like this from your backyard, I recommend it. It's a 0.7-meter telescope, so it's pretty big. It's very compact. It's about 8 feet tall. It's very sophisticated software. It's fully robotic. It's not that expensive. It costs about as much as a very fancy car. So we bought one of these things. Here it is, installed at Mt Hopkins in southern Arizona. Ordered ours with gold mirrors. That's because gold has significantly enhanced reflectivity at wavelengths of about 850 or 900 nanometers compared to aluminum. I didn't know that. And this has 3 mirrors, so the hit on the aluminum is actually pretty substantial. So gold mirrors, they're Slisky. There it is installed, and it's called an astrowave, and it's basically a part of us working for the it's pretty interesting. Yeah, the husband and wife who own this company, they drive it up, and they drop it down, and it takes like 2 hours. It's pretty amazing. It's, yeah, so, somewhat surprisingly, they claim to have sold thousands of these things, but they can't tell you who they sold them to. So it must have some space awareness. Some sort of passive or military application. Just open. That's it. We have this is a big dehumidifier fan. That's pretty neat. Okay, we have our telescope. Next thing to think about is what would the instrument look like? Well, there are lots of different design choices, I guess you could say, that drive the design for an instrument like this. Lots of But for us, I think what really matters is what's the size of the focused starlight? On the focal plane of this telescope, how big is the star? And that's important because, as I'll show, that's going to actually set now the size and scale and cost of our instrument. So it's a pretty small telescope. A small telescope will produce small stellar images. And in the infrared, what we'll be working to see is actually pretty good. So for this particular telescope at our site, the size of the star in normal conditions is about 20 microns, actually pretty small as far as this thing is going. And that's great, because it turns out that the spectral resolution of your instrument, you want spectral resolution as high as possible, is proportional to the size of the telescope. The size of the telescope determines the size of the stellar spot. And inversely proportional to the beam size. And here, beam size, I mean the size of the collimated light inside the instrument. That's a really important design factor because it sets the size of your optics, sets the size of your grating, and fundamentally it sets the cost. So at fixed spectral resolution, an instrument designed for a small telescope will have smaller optics, will have a smaller grating, and will have a smaller price tag. Really important question, Trace is getting at is, what wavelengths do you use? Right, you have a broad choice. I've already motivated moving to the infrared just because these objects stars are so much brighter. But you can actually do quite a bit better than that. You can really do a simulation where you take some hypothetical telescope instrument, maybe one that looks just like this is what I described here. Then you can take theoretical spectrum of those stars, and you can do a Monte Carlo simulation and say, okay, if photon noise is what's limiting me, what's the best I can do with my telescope? And that's what's shown here. My bottom graduate student at Caltech carried out a big simulation. What's shown here are contours of photon-limited Doppler precision as a function of the effective temperature of the star and the center of your wavelength. So basically, if I had an instrument that works at about 700 nanometers, and I want to look at a star that has a temperature of about 3100 Kelvin, these contours tell me that I should do about 25 meters a second with some hypothetical telescope and instrument and some fixed amount of time. So what's nice about this is it allows you to some are going to be worse, some are going to be better, and that's because of the information content. So if you just eyeball this quickly, for the coolest star, less than about 3,600 to 3,800 Kelvin, about here, you can do pretty well in this region, which I think of as the deep red, between about 700 nanometers and the micron. But you also do pretty well out here, in the proper infrared, about 2.3 microns. The trouble with infrared instruments is that they're very, very expensive. In this wavelength range, I can use a CCD. Out here, I have to have a Mercat teledetector, very, very expensive detector. You also have to worry about glow. The thermal emission from your instrument, your telescope, starts to matter. So from the instrumentation point of view, it's much better to be able to work here. Technically speaking, it's not the ultimate precision you can probably get, but the instrument's going to be much, much simpler. One somewhat annoying feature of this wavelength range is that, you know, water and oxygen all over the place, good for us, not so good for astronomy. These are bands of oxygen and water all throughout the red optical. You want to avoid these absorption features. I think it's a bit of an outstanding question if these can be excised out of your spectrum, if they can be modeled away, maybe. But for now, we're just going to take the tack of just avoiding. So if you want to avoid these water absorption features, if you want to work in the red, you're pretty much driven to what's approximately the SDSS ceiling, right around 850 to 860 nanometers. So that's the wavelength range. Ask yourself, what is a spectrometer? I spent a lot of time trying to answer that question, learning all about different spectrometers that people have built over the years. James Graham, of course, a crack spectrograph builder, I guess now at Berkeley, has a really nice sort of stylized version of National Spectrometer. You've got a source of light, diverging beam of starlight. It comes from a fiber or a slit. You're going to collimate that light. You do it with a lens. That collimated light is going to be incident on some sort of dispersive element. Grating, prism, whatever. It's going to be an angle of incidence, alpha, angle of diffraction, beta. These angles are related to the wavelength and the order through the grating equation. Then we're going to use some sort of focusing optic, a camera lens system, to focus that light onto a detector. So a spectrometer maps wavelength into physical position on the detector. And typically, for high spectral resolution, today people build what's called a shell spectrometer. So a shell spectrometer is based around a grating that has a very coarse number of lines per millimeter. It might have, say, 30 lines per millimeter instead of 2,000. And then you're going to illuminate this grating at a very high angle of incidence, as shown here. And you're going to work at very high spectrum. So if you want very high resolution, you can do this in first order with a very high line density, or you can do it in order 50 with a coarse grating illuminated at a high angle of incidence. That's in a shell. That's great. One sort of problem with a shell grating is that all of these orders end up overlapped on top of each other on your two-dimensional detector. That's not so good. So you use what's called a cross-dispersed. It could be a prism to spread out those orders, and it produces a beautiful shell grating. Looks like these are the shell orders here, from red to blue. And then within each order, so this is a very typical design for a shell spectrometer. So I designed a shell spectrometer for Minerva-Red. It's a very simple, very, very small instrument. In fact, it might be the simplest shell spectrometer you could possibly design. It uses off-the-shelf lenses. These are literally lenses out of a Thor Labs catalog, which is pretty neat. Collimate light, you find it over here. It's the smallest grating. Use a cross disperser to spread out those orders, and a very simple camera lens system to image those spectrum onto a deep depletion CCD. One thing that enables such a simple design is that we're really only focusing on this narrow region, 800 nanometers to about a micron. It means that you can really optimize all the glasses and photos in here to make it very efficient. It's also very small. I'll talk about that in a few slides, but this is half a meter. Much, much smaller. Fit on this lecture. It's much, much smaller than the typical astronomical spectrometer. So you got a telescope, you built an instrument. I'm sort of sad to say that's probably like 1% of the work, right? That's actually the easy part. Doppler spectroscopy is hard. That's because fundamentally what you want to do here is you want to take a spectrum like this one, and you want to say, okay, in the middle of that mix So what are you looking at? This is a vacuum vessel. Right? This is a vacuum vessel we bought from a company that sells these things to other companies to coat stuff. Not exactly sure what to do with them, but this is commercially available. 30 inches across. The vacuum chamber is important because, as you know, a change in the index of refraction of the air in this room would result in a wavelength shift of light going through the room. That looks exactly like the Doppler shift we're trying to detect. You've got to get rid of that, so you have to evacuate this. The vacuum chamber lives inside what we call an igloo, but as you can see, it's basically made out of construction materials, wrapped in clothes. This is 3-inch thick foam, I guess, that you would insulate your house with. And that's important because thermal changes in the instrument also can look just like Doppler shifts. So the grating is on a piece of glass. And even if I get the fanciest glass I could buy, 0 to the lowest coefficient of thermal expansion, you keep that grating up a little bit, the line spacing changes. And because of the grating equation, now my spectra are moving all over my detector. So you want to be able to keep this whole apparatus to about plus or minus 10. So we do that by putting it inside this box and actually just using little resistors on a closed loop temperature controller. So it turns the resistor on to heat up the box and maintain it about 10 degrees above ambient. And the resistor turns off, the box cools it on, off. It's a very simple system. We're getting a few millikelvins. So again, sort of off the shelf industrial control. You might be wondering about our wavelength range, Z band. If you've looked at Sloan images, if you've worked with Sloan data, you know that CCDs are not so sensitive, 850 nanometers. Thankfully, today you can buy something called a deep depletion CCD. So, this is a CCD that has thicker silicon that makes it more sensitive to red light. It also dramatically reduces the etaloning effect. We call that fringing. Photons come in, bounce off the backside of the CCD, and then interfere with other photons at the same wavelength. And this is pretty great. It has quantum efficiency of something like 80% of the wavelengths we care about, about 850 nanometers. And you've got to get this chip cool to reduce the dark current. And we can do this actually with just thermoelectric coolers buffered to chilled water, so we don't need any nitrogen. So this is a commercially available quantum field. It's about a third of the cooler. It does not. That's right, it's overheated. So we keep this at about 80. So you just radiate it like cooler to the outside. That happens there. It's not sealed up on the cooler. So we turn off the heaters. Here's a picture of the optics inside. It's a very, very simple spectrometer. Again, it has a resolution of about 50,000. Aficionados in the room. It's modest resolution by these standards, but we think is sufficient for our science. And that's in large part because these low-mass stars tend to spin rather rapidly. So actually, you don't gain that much by having a much higher resolution instrument. You've already resolved the stellar quantities at this resolution. In a single shot, we get this wavelength coverage. Simple optics, commercial off the shelf, right out of the Thor Labs catalog. And we have to calibrate this thing. It's not enough to take a spectrum of a star. You have to know exactly, very precisely, I should say, the wavelength of light falling on each pixel. And we're going to do that with a uranium neon lamp and a really cool gizmo called a fiber fabric probe, which I'll describe on a few more slides. Now, you might ask, how is it that this instrument is so small? You've been to the Keck telescope or Apache Point. You see the instruments that are attached to those telescopes, they're enormous, right? The spectrometer for the Keck telescope is huge. Why is this thing only 30 inches across? That's because we're feeding it with a very, very tiny fiber, a single mode fiber in this case. Here's a sort of schematic of a multi-mode fiber and a schematic of a single mode fiber. The smallest multi-mode fiber is about 50 microns across, and a single mode fiber is typically 5 microns. Almost all astronomical instruments you've ever heard of use multi-mode fiber. Bigger buckets get that light. But if you use a small fiber, there are a lot of advantages. This is like having a very tiny slit on your spectrograph. As you know, if you have a tiny slit on your spectrograph, you can get high spectral resolution with small optics. Small optics, that is a small grating, small lenses, means a small and inexpensive instrument. So in terms of the size of the instrument, having single mode fiber feed is hugely, hugely advantageous. You also avoid the dreaded modal noise. So modal noise is some up even for months. Correlation, input illumination pattern, output velocity. Single mode fiber simply does not have this problem. If you use single mode fiber, you can do an end run around this really bad problem. Simply get to it. But wait a minute, you might say, this is a total scam, right? There's no way you're going to get any light out of that mode fiber. That would be a fair question. A single mode fiber has one single Gaussian input mode, as the name implies, right? That's it. It couples to a laser pretty effectively. Doesn't couple to starlight very effectively. That's because Earth's atmosphere aberrates starlight. So by the time the starlight gets through the atmosphere and gets to the focal plane of our telescope, it looks like that. That is most definitely not the Gaussian. Doesn't couple to single mode fiber very effectively. That's a big problem. And that's the reason people haven't really pursued instrumentation using single mode fibers in the past. That's where the sort of burgeoning field of astrophotonics comes in, something I'm very excited about, which basically boils down to taking some telecoms hardware, which is fundamentally based on single mode fibers, and figuring out how to hook it up to your astronomical instrument. We're going to use, with Minerva-Red, something called a photonic lantern. Take a bundle of single mode fibers, you put it in a glass capillary tube, you heat it up, you squeeze it, and you stretch it. So on one end, you now have some single mode fibers that are really not independent anymore. Their modes have overlapped, and you have something that now behaves like a multi-mode fiber. So you can stick that on the sky. On the other end now, I've got all these single mode fibers hanging on the other end. You can align these things in a slit, in a pseudo slit. And you can attach this right to your instrument. So this is the best of both worlds. You get the coupling efficiency on the sky of a multi-mode fiber. You get the small slit and also the stability of illumination of the single mode fibers. This is the photonic lantern. I think this will have lots of applications for lots of different astronomical instruments. That's a fairly new technology that's been demonstrated on sky with different types of instruments over the last few years. But we think that this will be the first time it's been used for Doppler spectroscopy. And we're working with collaborators in the UK, including this company Optical, to manufacture this. That's actually the key issue you hit right on. So this doesn't solve all your problems because sometimes one of these 19 channels can go wrong. So you take a big read lens. I've now spread my light out over 19 more pixels. So any noise sources intrinsic to your detector are much worse. And you're absolutely right, the light is not going to be evenly spread over these modes. Some of the modes are going to have very low signal noise, and some are going to have much higher signal noise. The ones that don't have much flux, they might not have enough flux to get above the read noise that the detector, and then you've lost that channel noise. So that's a key point. Another question? That's right, so we have a guiding system that works pretty well for 30 minutes. It does a good job of that tip. Yeah, so the vacuum chamber will live in a hub basically next to the telescope that has its own HVAC system to keep it pretty stable temperature-wise. So it's about 15 meters from the telescope focus to the hub. So working with these fibers is not that easy. So this is a picture of an actual fiber to show you that it's a real thing. I like that our Scottish colleagues have helpfully labeled this an important sign. This is four of these lanterns in here. So this is the fused end, the multimode end, which goes on sky. This is extremely fragile. So you can't see it here, but there's a little like half inch, 30 micron wide piece of glass. So these are actually relatively easy to manufacture. They're just hard to make. Okay, step two in my plan for building a rock-solid instrument, you've got to calibrate this thing optimally. You should have an instrument that's intrinsically stable. Then you should observe some sort of source that you know very good job of calibrating a spectrometer like this for over a decade. We would actually use, we will use, uranium. It turns out that uranium, it's uranium oxide, so it's something you can just buy. It's not an issue in terms of controlled substances. It has a lot of lines, an 850 nanometer wavelength, which is even nanometer. So we'll use a uranium neon lamp as a primary wavelength reference. But we'll also use this very cool gizmo, another piece of telecoms hardware called a fiber-based fabric burrow. So as you know, a fabric burrow cavity, it's two faces, two optical surfaces that are highly polished. And then the distance between those surfaces will determine the spacing of the wavelengths of light that get through. This is a fabric burrow that's all in fiber, so it's extremely small. Imagine taking a piece of single mode fiber, slicing it, polishing the faces, putting a dielectric mirror on them so they're super duper reflective, and then using some ceramic material under a microscope to place them just the right distance apart to make the cavity we want. And that's what we've done. What's nice about having it be physically small, just a few microns, is you can wrap it layer upon layer of temperature control. And you can keep this Fabry Pro Edelon stable to some microns. And that's important because the Achilles heel for any Edelon as a reference source is that if the temperature of this thing changes, all bets are off. Your cavity changes, all the transmitted modes are going to change, and it's no longer useful as a reference source. So Sam Halverson is a grad student at Penn State. He's really pioneered the use of these fiber fabric pros for calibrating astronomical instruments. In fact, he took one to APO, So this is a really neat technology. It's very small. It's backlighted with a broadband white light source. And out the other side comes a beautiful forest of emission features with which you can calibrate your instrument. So this is a spectrum of a neon. An old-fashioned neon lamp taken with a prototype instrument on the top. See, not so many levels. Not good for calibrating the instrument. Next line down, this is a spectrum of one of Sam's fiber-based forest of emission features. We know the wavelengths for each of those things. Almost an ideal source for calibrating a spectrum. Anyone who's ever dealt with a laser frequency cone or heard about the laser frequency cone, this is a fabulous piece of hardware. That's probably the perfect wavelength calibrator for any type of spectroscopy. It produces data that look just like this, except it costs about 30 times as much. So this is like an extremely simple, extremely inexpensive laser. I'll finish up here with current status. As I mentioned, the first telescope was installed in May 2015. It's at this site called Mt Hopkins, which is way in southern Arizona near Tucson. So it's a Smithsonian site. The MMT is here, for example. The Earth Project is here. Gaspar's telescopes are right there. And then the Minerva telescopes are here. First one installed in 2015. I should mention that our instrument, Minerva-Red spectrometer, is actually designed from the get-go to work with two telescopes. So we just have one here. There's a multiplexing advantage there, running two telescopes in one. Here's a picture of the site. It's actually kind of a little colony of telescopes doing lots of different exciting exoplanet science. These four telescopes are part of the Minerva project, and this is Minerva-Red. So we're sort of a sibling project of the miniature exoplanet radio velocity array. It's a bit of a tortured afternoon. PI of Minerva is John Johnson at Harvard. So we're focusing on infrared exoplanet science in these four telescopes. We'll do lots of exciting optical cameras. See if this works here. All right. So the folks from the telescope company, when they came to install these telescopes, brought the drone. This is a drone here at the site. You'll see those start dancing. It's a bigger tune. We have approval from the Forest Service, this National Park. We have approval for two. We hope to someday have seven telescopes in the city. Yeah. There are some interesting stories about that, but this costs about $30,000. This costs quite a bit more. So, yeah, the Astrohaven is a wonderfully simple piece of hardware. It's a tiny amount of money. Probably not. We would like one more Minerva-Red, which will go here. Optical. Lighting's a really bad problem. is simulating the population of exoplanets we expect to be orbiting some of the nearest stars to the sun, our nearest neighbors. Tantalizing evidence from Kepler and ongoing Doppler surveys seems to indicate there should be a lot of planets orbiting these stars, but their signals are probably just below the parameter space we've been probing so far. So Minerva-Red is designed to be sensitive to planets in this box. These are high-value planets. These are planets where decades down the road you might help hook to use some very fancy space-based apparatus to take spectra of the planet atmospheres. And our goal is 1 meter a second or better precision for all of the M stars. Next slide is the conclusion. So I'll throw that up there, and then I'll go to this. I have a slide about activity. All right. So in conclusion, yeah, we expect there to be dozens of sort of undiscovered planets kind of lurking in the immediate solar neighborhood. But to get at these planets, you really need kind of a new type of instrument. It's not so much different from what's been built before, but it's optimized for the right wavelengths for these little stars at brightest. And a small telescope can play a big role. This is not a huge telescope, right? 0.7 meters. But we have all the time. Can intensively observe, say, the closest dozen or so of these telescopes, really very near standards. And that's Minerva-Red. So it's the 70-centimeter telescope at Mt Hopkins, first light with the spectrometer should be pretty soon. Mostly off-the-shelf parts, which is pretty exciting. I mean, somebody could replicate this if they were so inclined. And I also think of it as a testbed for astrophotonic devices, basically ways to get starlight down single mode fibers and into astrophotonics. That's actually been simulated. There's a paper by Eric Guidos where he's taking a similar sort of path here, making a tally of all the stars closest to the sun, figuring out what the population of transiting planets should be. But in rough terms, it's a few percent max. So if there are 3 dozen RV planets, I would expect 5% of the transiting planets. Small wavelength range, although the ionized cell on high-res is about 100 nanometers. This is 50 or 60. That's up to perhaps about 2,000 angstroms. All of the observing time is a major advantage here. So HARPS is totally dedicated now to exoplanet science. That's not the case for any of the high-resolution Doppler spectrometers that are coming online in the coming years. So we have all of the observing time here, and we're really going to focus on very intensive high-gain observations of a small number of targets instead of doing the quads. We're operating under the assumption that Barnard's star should have a system of planets. You actually might adopt a strategy of just making 5 stars and just observing like crazy. Activity is a big problem, right? So we found with Kepler, one of the interesting things about Kepler is that it has a principle of photometric precision to detect Earth transiting in front of the sun. But the problem is that the sun ends up being a slightly quieter than average star. So Kepler was designed with the sun in mind, but the sun is below average, so most stars have activity, little photometric variations that limit your ability to detect a transiting Earth. The exact same thing happens with radio velocities, and in fact, it's probably even worse. Small spectral variations due to, say, chromospheric activity or star spots translate directly into Earth issues. It's a big problem. We hope to get around this problem, one, by observing at better wavelengths. So if you have RV ships caused by spots on the surface moving in and out of the field of view, the contrast of the spot to the rest of the Earth does simultaneous narrowband communication. So we're always going to be spinning through CW filters that are tagged to specific emission lines. You might see in the spectrum, H alpha, calcium HK, H beta, where we use this as a diagnostic. So if we see photometric variability in these lines that seems to correlate with the RV variability we measure in the spectrograph, we'll probably toss it out. Kepler, except it's the whole sky and looking at brighter stars. So when TESS starts doing its thing in 2017 or 18, we're going to have more planet candidates than we can possibly do with. And experience has shown that, you know, for every, say, 5,000 things that look like a beautiful transit planet, you've got to get through all the horrible, pernicious ways stars can conspire to do things that look just like a transit, and maybe you're lucky to get 50 planets in the end. So there's tons of work there that Minerva-Red will be. Cullen 2015. This is a simulation like the one I did, but for TESS. So this is the whole sky. And this is the brightness of the star in I band, so that everyone can use. The RV amplitude of the hypothetical planet on one axis and the temperature of the star is encoded. So Minerva-Red is designed for these cool stars. You see, we're expecting literally hundreds of planets from TESS in this bit of parameter space. So I anticipate that Minerva-Red will spend a bunch of its time doing follow-up observations and testing. Yeah. Absolutely, and the way my brain may have chosen is somewhat. Scratch your head and say, oh dear, that sounds bad, because that's a chromosphere in Cullen, right? But it turns out for these very low mass stars, there's little evidence, at least evidence that I can find in the literature, that there seems to be any activity in these lines. So they are chromospheric lines, but they're at the very bottom of the chromosphere. So you're absolutely right that these could be more active than these other ones, which are due to things like iron, magnesium, titanium, oxide. So it's a concern, but you can also flip it around and say it's a diagnostic. So if we see obvious, say, profile changes in these lines over time, that would be a huge warning sign, something that we might be able to use as a diagnostic. We do. So the hydrogen ring stars within 10 parsecs, within 10, we know them within 8, and I'm less certain about 10, and I only know it's true for 8 because these folks in Georgia have been working for decades trying to build up the capital, and theirs is claiming the volume limited up to 8. But I will show you the map of this. Down in this regime, so these are